Begin our appropriations meeting. Our purpose of gathering today is to hear budget amendments from members of the committee. We will proceed in alpha order and we'll call each member. And as I indicated to other members of the House, I ask that you only present your top three budget amendment priorities, and then we have another matter to take up at the end of hearing budget recommendations from the members. So thank you all for joining us this morning. Before we begin, I'm going to ask the clerk if he would take the attendance, please.
Hey, Mr. Chairman, I'm here. I just can't get my iPad to work here for a second. It's Delegate Hurst.
Okay.
Delegate Hurst, how have you done?
Mr. Chairman, same with me on my voting iPad. I'm here.
Mr. Chairman, it's Delegate Brewer. I'm here as well.
Thank you.
Delegate Sickles, Delegate Brewer, I have you all down. Delegate Davis. Delegate Davis.
Okay, Mr. Clerk, you can close the roll. Okay, Ann, we'll turn it over to you so we can get started, please.
Good morning, everyone. 17 members of the committee have proposed budget amendments. You all should have received a packet. The first two pages have the members listed with their amendments following them, and then the amendments themselves follow. Given that we are going in alphabetical order, it should be easy to follow along as the packet was printed in patron order. First up would be Delegate Aird, and she begins on page one of the attachment.
Thank you. Good morning. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay. Good morning, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. Today, I'll be presenting three budget amendments dealing with healthcare and COVID-19 relief. And I'm going to start with Amendment 4-14 4H. Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, this amendment establishes an emergency debt repayment plan for utilities. Mr. Chairman and members, I've introduced this budget amendment because at the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic, I saw firsthand the hardship that many families in my district were experiencing as a result of not having access to water. And while this particular situation was unique, yet unfortunate, I worry deeply about the circumstances we will see across this Commonwealth when the moratorium on utilities are lifted. I believe we have an obligation to anticipate that individuals and households who are not just low income, but are experiencing hardship throughout the Commonwealth will have once these moratoriums are lifted. And as a result, after many, many conversations with utilities, I've introduced this language, and you may have seen something very similar that was in the governor's introduced. And so this is another variation of that. Ultimately, what this language amendment would do is a few things. It asks utilities, both jurisdictional and non-jurisdictional, to arrange an emergency debt repayment plan that goes a bit further than what they do right now. Most utilities offer a debt repayment plan between 6 to 12 months. This language would ask that households receive an additional cushion of up to 24 months. And it's up to so that in the event that a household does not need as long, they don't have to go that far. But we're asking that you can stretch the arrearages out to 24 months. In addition to that, it will require no deposit, no down payment, no fees to enter in this repayment plan as to not restrict families who are experiencing hardship. And in addition to that, as long as the customer is within good standing, this payment with the payment plan, they won't be disconnected. Mr. Chairman, as someone who has personally experienced utility disconnection as a child, I can tell you that unless you have been through this, you have no idea how difficult this hardship is, especially during this COVID-19 pandemic. And so I think that this is the least we can do to offer utility customers some additional relief. And so I hope the committee will give this amendment its full consideration. Mr. Chairman,
one of the things that I failed to mention to each member, I'm going to ask that you keep your comments to 2 minutes or less on each of your amendments. We have quite a few to get through. So presenting your amendments in a concise manner would be extremely helpful to our time together this morning.
Go to Umber to come in.
Totally prepared to do that, Mr. Chairman. The next item is 313-11H. This amendment is language only, and it directs DMAS to do preparation work required to create a demonstration project for home visiting services. The reason why I'm introducing this language amendment is because Governor Northam included funding for home visiting to the Medicaid program in its original budget, but unfortunately those dollars were unallotted. And so what this language amendment does is, instead of requesting that language, this allows DMAS to lay the groundwork for a demonstration project, and that would allow the project to launch in fiscal year 22. Right now, the way we're doing home visiting is using a combination of federal funds and state TANF funds. And ultimately, if we were to explore Medicaid as an additional funder, we could allow the state to leverage additional federal dollars. And ultimately, the importance of this language is, as we continue to try and combat the maternal and infant mortality disparity here in the Commonwealth, this would allow families, mothers to have an additional tool of support. And lastly, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, I am presenting item 313-10H. This item will reverse Medicaid reimbursement cuts to the emergency physicians and hospitals on the front lines of this COVID-19 crisis. The fiscal year 20 and 21 biennium budget included language that drastically reduced the Medicaid reimbursement for emergency room claims. And as we are seeing the extreme difficult time that hospitals are experiencing as a result of the pandemic, this ultimately could not come at a worse time. And I think the worst part about it is these cuts are impacting majority Black and Brown communities that have a concentration of low-income citizens with healthcare needs. And so this language would ultimately undo what we did in the fiscal year 2021 biennium. And so I hope the committee will give full consideration, and that completes my presentations of my three amendments. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, next up would be Delegate Austin, and his amendment is on page 3.
Mr. Chairman.
Delegate Austin.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, I bring before you today budget amendment 482.20-16H. Seeks to restore funding for Health Sciences and Technologies pilot program at Virginia Western Community College. This program will give students in the Roanoke Valley and surrounding counties the opportunity to acquire stackable credentials starting in high school and continuing through community colleges and a four-year institution. The healthcare industry today faces a shortage of qualified workers, and in the next decade, more than 122,000 healthcare-related jobs will be needed in the Commonwealth. Far too often, we hear of graduates who are not properly qualified for current or future job opportunities. This preparation is needed for academics to write their curricula for next year to match employer career paths. The intention is to expand the pilot program to a statewide standardized curricula. It has the support of Carilion Medical Facilities and Carilion Clinic, Medical Facilities of American Friendship Manor, and Richfield for internships, educators, and the Claude Moore Foundation. We have partnered with former Secretary Dr. Bill Hazel, who is now with the Claude Moore Foundation. Also, Megan Healy, Secretary Carney, and Secretary Kerry all support this program. I'm confident we will have an institutional knowledge to create a pipeline that establishes Virginia as a leader in healthcare sciences. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I would ask for support from the committee.
Thank you, Delegate.
And next up is Delegate Bloxham. His amendment is on page 4.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. House Amendment C61.51H restores the funding that we approved in January to build a hangar at the Melfa Airport to complete the master plan. And the reason why I think it's important to reinstate that funding is because we also in the spring tied the funding to the Virginia Spaceport to the Transportation Trust Fund. And with the funding being reduced at the Virginia Spaceport, just because we changed it from a direct money allocation to a percentage, the spaceport has actually had to cut all of the contracts they had with outside independent people. So now they're looking for places to house their operations. The choice is either Melfa Airport or Salisbury, Maryland. So we're kind of in a competition with Salisbury, Maryland. The county has stepped up and we've got one hangar under the process of being purchased by the county. And I was hoping the state could step up and do a second one. So this business would go to Melfa instead of to Salisbury. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee for your consideration.
Thank you.
Next up is Delegate Brewer, also on page 4.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. Today I have budget amendment 42.20 57H, and this is for appropriation of $5.6 million in year two. What this is designed to do is to increase the family service worker salaries 20%, which was a recommendation of the 2018 JLARC study. Right now, family service workers in this realm make on average around $30,000 a year, which is just barely above the federal poverty level. So this did come as a recommendation out of the JLARC report. Furthermore, just the pandemic is going to compound the workload and the stress level, especially for these foster care workers. And more importantly, when children start to return to school, some of the stress fractures of a family structure are going to continually show the cracks, and these workers are going to be obviously first line of defense to handle so many complex situations. So I would ask that the committee give consideration to supporting this budget amendment. Thank you.
Next up is Delegate Bulova. His amendments begin on page 5.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and good morning. I really appreciate the opportunity to speak on these amendments. I just want to highlight two of them. Both of them touch on education, which I know has been and will continue to be a priority for the committee. During the 2020 session, we made considerable progress on a number of educational fronts, and I think we were all sorry to see that many of these were unallotted, and they're certainly important to go forward. However, for most of these unallotments, it means simply holding the line for the time being. In the case of the two amendments I wanted to highlight, these are areas where I think we risk going backwards and losing precious ground, and I think that's why I wanted to go ahead and highlight them. The first one is item 479.10, number 8H. What this bill would do would earmark $80 million from federal relief funds to provide child care stabilization grants to community partners and programs. These grants would be developed by Department of Social Services and Department of Education to protect our child care infrastructure and make sure that our struggling programs can remain open. I wanted to point out a couple of statistics about why I think this is really important to do at this time. So according to DSS, 42% of regulated child care capacity in Virginia is closed because of COVID-19. So that's nearly half of our child care capacity. And I think even more alarming is that 38% of those sites that are still open report that they might not be able to stay in business for another 6 months. At the same time, we are starting to see a perfect storm with respect to need. And so you have parents who are struggling to find childcare so they can go back to work. I think it's important to remember that nearly 75% of Virginia's children under age 5 spend time outside of the home for care. And then at the same time, parents with children over age 5 who would normally be going back to school are also looking for childcare. And so in Virginia, we have about half of our school divisions planning for opening virtually, and there could be up to about 45,000 children in need of that childcare. And so Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, early childhood education is the foundation of not only our educational system, it's really the foundation of our economy and is what's going to allow us to be able to dig ourselves out of the economic problems that COVID-19 has created for us. And so we want to make sure with this money that we're not losing infrastructure needed to get Virginia to work again. The second bill or second item is 482.20 number 34H. What this does is reallots $10 million, the amount unallotted for George Mason University in the first year. And so again, this last session, I was really, really happy to support our priority and your focus on the affordability of higher education. And while a lot of the unallotted budget has to do with tuition stabilization, I just want to make sure we remember that some of that funding was actually meant to simply pull some of our institutions of higher education out of a hole and bring them up to a closer level of per pupil funding for other state universities. And so George Mason University is one of those. And so as a result of that $10 million loss, George Mason doesn't just stand still. We actually let go and let them slip back into that home. And so, Mr. Chairman, I realize that all of our universities are struggling, but the fact is over the last 10 years, George Mason has accounted for nearly 60% of our undergraduate enrollment growth, and that's put a huge strain on their budget. And so I simply request that as we consider reallotting funding for higher education, that we recognize that not all universities are starting from the same place and that we prioritize those universities that step up to the plate and serve Virginia's growing student population. So thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee.
Thank you, Delegate Bova.
Next up is Delegate Carr, and her amendments begin on page 9.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. I'm asking your consideration of amendments on page 10 and 2 on page 12. The first is budget amendment. It's item 247, number 1H, to restore $1 million of general fund support in each year of the biennium for the state aid to local public libraries. This funding was approved during the 2020 session, but then was unallocated. Local public libraries are playing a very key role in assisting their patrons during the COVID-19 epidemic with broadband access, job search assistance, and virtual learning. The increased funding would be used for these purposes. I have detailed information available for anybody who's interested in the subject. The next is item 482.20, number 30H on page 12. It's about pilot projects to reduce state mental hospital census. It restores $7.5 million each year from the general fund for pilot projects to reduce the state mental health hospital census. These funds were included in the budget passed in March, but subsequently unallotted in April due to the pandemic and eliminated in the introduced budget. The goal of this is to alleviate the current crisis in bed capacity and provide community alternatives to serve individuals who are ready for discharge. Pilot projects can test alternatives to better meet patient needs. State hospitals serve about 1,500 additional individuals each year. While admissions declined March through May due to COVID-19, by June, admissions increased by 15% over the FY 2019 levels. By the end of July, 6 of the 9 facilities had census counts approaching 100%. A state hospital geriatric bed census is at a crisis level. Just an example, Southwest Virginia Mental Health Institute is 110% capacity, recently as high as 115% capacity. More than 200 individuals are ready to be discharged from state hospitals but are facing extraordinary barriers to community placement. Almost 41% are waiting on appropriate placement in an assisted living facility or nursing home with another provider but need specialty services and a willing provider. If funding cannot be provided now, this would merit consideration as a contingent appropriation if the fall revenue forecast does not indicate an additional decline in revenues. And lastly, Mr. Chairman, item 482.20.58 on page 13, this would restore rates for mental health providers. And then restores $2.4 million each year from the general fund for an increase in the Medicaid mental health provider rates to 110% of Medicare. These funds were included in the budget passed in March, but subsequently unallotted in April due to the pandemic and eliminated in the introduced budget. COVID-19 has dramatically increased the need for mental health services, as we're seeing in the paper, something about, I think, a 65% increase in suicide and so forth. This increase is needed to improve access to mental health services by attracting more providers to serve Medicaid enrollees. If funding cannot be provided now, this would certainly merit consideration as a contingent appropriation if the fall revenue forecast does not indicate an additional decline in revenues. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the opportunity to present these.
Thank you, Delegate Carr.
Next up is Delegate Cox, whose amendments begin on page 14.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm going to start with 145.5H. That's actually on page 43. It's going to be the first one I pick. This deals with, I guess, my two K-12 amendments. There were two topics I've heard so much about from parents and teachers, et cetera. That is trying to open schools as quickly as possible. And if they're not going to open, how can we be flexible to help parents sort of navigate their way through the pandemic? So the first one allows for flexible use of direct aid funds in 2021 to either support school reopening or virtual learning. I think a lot of you know that that's a big pot of money if you look at basic aid and categorical grants and lottery, et cetera. Some things are untouchable in those particular categories like VRS and group life, but there are certain things that are not, like at-risk add-on. I can't think of a better topic than to add flexibility there, because a lot of our students and parents who are at-risk could really use this flexibility. Infrastructure and operations per pupil fund we created this year sort of has the same effect. That's about $262 million. And I'll finally say this on that amendment, Mr. Chairman. We do this with SOQ staffing standards. We offer flexibility, so I think that's smart. The second one is 479.101H. I've talked about this one many times. This is called the READ Fund. That is the Reimbursement for Education Access Decisions Fund. And as much as I like to have seen a lot of systems go 5-day and have the option for that in virtual, a lot have gone virtual. So what this does is it allows the localities permissively to establish programs. It takes $100 million worth of CARES money. The state can use part of theirs for a match. The locality can use part of theirs for a match. You know, parents really need options right now. They're struggling. Some of them would like to do tutoring. They would like to do teaching pods. They would like to have more hardware and software and internet access. They just don't have the money. So I think if they knew there was a fund they could access for a variety of these capabilities, it would really help them negotiate and give them a lifeline, both parents and students. So the READ Fund can certainly be worded a lot of different ways, Mr. Chairman, but that's a priority. And finally, Mr. Chairman, higher ed, this would be item 482.201H. You're very familiar with this one. This is just the Restore Tuition Moderation Funding. You've pushed this as a core priority. I pushed this. So I'd like to see us do something there. So, Mr. Chairman, I really appreciate the opportunity and the time to present my budget amendments.
Thank you, Delegate Cox.
And next up would be Delegate Ferris. His amendment begins on page 17.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, Delegate Ferris.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. My amendment is on page 17. It's 482.207H. And I just want to make sure that we leave the funding in for House Bill 599 dealing with the police departments. And I'm not sure that the wording's right here on the sheet that I have, but I want to leave that funding in, and it appears that maybe that it is left in, and for some reason this looks like it reads to me that I'm trying to take it out, but I want to leave that funding in that we added when we left. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Doug Ferris.
Next up is Delegate Hayes. His amendments begin on page 18.
Thank you. Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. Mr. Chairman, committee members, I had two budget requests. One was item 145-6H. The other was item 313-9H. I'll start with item 145-6H. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, as part of the governor's revisions to the biennial budget, there's a technical amendment to the sales tax revenue estimates that will result in a significant cut to K-12 funding. This would impact every school division across the Commonwealth if no action is actually taken. And so we're simply asking, because this technical amendment would result in a net reduction of $188 million as appropriated, the sales tax revenues over the biennium. Public schools would see a reduction of $95 million of a cut as a result in the current year and $93.6 million in the second year. The impact of this funding loss on each school division would vary considerably because of its distributed based on education, based on the school age population estimates in our school divisions. But every division in the state would experience a resulting budget current reduction in its current year funding. What I'm asking for favorable consideration with this committee is to provide one-time funding to the budget to hold divisions harmless in the current year for the projected sales tax revenue deadline. And while the biennial reduction is something certainly that concerns us all across the Commonwealth for various school divisions, all of our school divisions, there will be an opportunity for us to deal with the second year when January comes. And so, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, I'm asking for favorable consideration for this budget amendment. The second budget amendment, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, item 313-9H, I'm simply asking that we strike this request. We've had an update regarding this, what this amendment would have done. The hospital has now received additional CARES Act revenues that we were not expecting. And so this request is no longer needed. So, Mr. Chairman, I'm asking that we strike item 313-9H. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee.
Thank you, Delegate.
Next up is Delegate Hurst on page 19.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. I'll direct your attention to my only budget amendment, which is item 479.10, number 9H, which would allocate $10 million in CARES Act funds for a comprehensive COVID-19 public information campaign. Clearly, we've seen throughout the world that there is an urgent need for clear, reliable, and consistent information to all residents about the continued importance of things like social distancing and wearing a mask. It's especially important in our minority communities, our African American, Latinx, rural, and other at-risk populations around the state where there are disproportionately high COVID-19 numbers. And now we're seeing also, too, the urgency in college communities. Certainly, we're seeing that here in the New River Valley. We have seen, though, that readership and viewership of news media has increased significantly during the pandemic as people are turning to newspapers and local broadcast media as trusted news sources for public health and government information. We have 90% of all Virginians listening to Virginia radio stations on a weekly basis, and we have 2 million people who watch Virginia broadcast television stations each and every day. So as businesses and schools continue to reopen, accurate, straightforward, repetitive, and official information is going to be vital in making sure that we are able to get proper information and oftentimes changing information depending on what positivity rates and what case information looks like in a particular area, region, hotspot at any particular time while we're continuing to fight the COVID pandemic. So this would leverage the Department of Health to be able to work with all of our media partners throughout the Commonwealth to be able to comprehensively address the information shortfall that we continue to see, and being able to provide high quality, accurate, and up-to-date information from reliable sources like the Department of Health that would be able to be disseminated through our broadcast and newspaper and internet partners to be able to, again, inform our public and make sure that they're doing what they need to be doing in order to keep all of us safe and hopefully eliminate this urgent need for combating this vaccine in the near future. So I'd hope it would be looked upon favorably by you, the members of the committee. And Mr. Chairman, I thank you for your time.
Thank you, Delegate.
Next up is Delegate Jones, whose amendments begin on page 20.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And the first amendment that I would draw your attention to is number 1351H. This amendment would provide a $10 million grant to a Virginia-based biotechnical company to support clinical trials as it moves towards COVID-19 testing at the human phase, enabling this company to rapidly respond to the need for holistic treatment for the effects of COVID-19 and scale up to meet this need. In return for the grant, the company would provide equity to VPA, a preference for Virginia hospitals in phase 3 clinical trials, and a preference to Virginia pharmaceutical manufacturers for production of its COVID-19 treatment. And they'll work with the Commonwealth to recruit new manufacturers to the state, especially in Go Virginia Region 4 in the bioscience health cluster, where that's become a priority. The second amendment that I would draw your attention to is 381H. This would establish a full-time position for an environmental justice director at the DEQ. The person would be tasked with directing and ensuring the implementation of urgent EJ matters directed in inconsistency with recent legislation. I think particularly now in the midst of a global health crisis that is disproportionately impacting Black and Brown Virginians, we can't afford to ignore environmental justice. Research shows that long-term exposure to PM2.5 is associated with higher mortality rates in individuals who have a COVID-19 infection, and communities of color and low-income communities disproportionately host this pollution and are disproportionately losing their lives. And an EJ director would be able to fully fund and fully implement legislation like House Bill 1162, 1042, and others from this past session. The final amendment that I would draw your attention to is 4.14, number 3H, which directs the State Corporation Commission to conduct an emergency investigation of the earnings of investor-owned utilities and to credit the bills for those earnings above 70 basis points above the utility's authorized rate of return for the years of 2017 to 2019. It also provides for a triennial review conducted for the utility in 2021. That shall order that the bill credits for any earnings above those 70 basis points above the utility authorized rate of return shall be returned to the folks of the Commonwealth. Now, I would just say that we are facing these uncertain times and we see people who are struggling. COVID has impacted just about everybody, and your electric bills continue to come in. And we think that this would be an important step in putting some money back in folks' pockets for us to do this and direct that action and give some citizens across Virginia some much needed relief. So I thank the chairman. I thank the committee for your time.
Thank you, Delegate.
And next up is Delegate Knight on page 23.
Mr. Chairman, my budget amendment restores project funding for Sandbridge Access due to flooding. We have a situation down here where we have dam neck base, which is where Dev Group is located, which includes SEAL Team 6. They're very, very sensitive. Their operations are, when Sandbridge floods, which they do 5 to 6 times or more per year, the residents down there, which is a few thousand, they cannot get out. It's the only way in, only way out. And Dam Neck puts guards up at their discretion at intersections and lets the residents come and go through their base, which is highly sensitive. They're under no obligation to do this whatsoever. If they had a sensitive operation, these people could be isolated for days and days on end. So I would just ask to restore this funding. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Delegate.
Next up is Delegate Krizek on page 24.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have three budget amendments for you today. The first is 4436, number 3H. This is a language-only amendment related to DMV online driver education. It's been a big issue for my constituents, and it's supported and requested by the agency. The amendment gives the DMV commissioner flexibility to allow driver training schools providing training and skills testing for regular driver's license applicants to administer the certain portions of the driver education curriculum online during this declared state of an emergency. The second, Mr. Chairman, is 479.10, number 11H. And this amendment authorizes the use of COVID-19 relief funds to provide $882,500 from the CARES Act to enable the Virginia Mental Health Access Program, VMAP, to respond to a serious children's mental health crisis that's being experienced right now as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic. This is really a COVID crisis-induced mental health emergency. Since the start of the pandemic, primary care providers are seeing 88% increase in the number of children with mental health issues, 88%. The sudden and traumatic experiences of changes to our daily routines and social isolation, the increased family stress, challenge of virtual education, have resulted in an escalating number of children with mental health disorders. Right now, VMAP is only functioning in two regions in the Commonwealth. And with that, this money will allow them to function in all across the Commonwealth. Let me just read you really quickly what one pediatrician in Norfolk said. I have a 15-year-old patient who previously had well-controlled depression. During the quarantine, her condition worsened and she had suicidal ideation, which necessitated her hospitalization. Upon discharge, she continued to struggle. I called the VMAP psychiatrist to help adjust her medications and to keep her safe and out of the hospital. Now she's doing better. So you can see that this has a big impact, and luckily she was in one of the regions where VMAP is available right now. So this, I also wanna say that we had allocated $4.22 million per year to expand VMAP statewide, but due to the COVID, this funding was unallotted, as you know, in April. The final amendment I'll share with you today is 482.20, number 24H, which requests restoration of $500,000 in funding for the pre- and post-incarceration services. That's known as PAPIS program, originally approved by the General Assembly in 2020. Before, in fact, we had approved it for $1 million for both fiscal 21, and $1 million for fiscal 22. This is just to bring back $500,000, which is enough to provide some services to individuals that are getting ready to be released from incarceration with the goal of reducing or improving their outcomes and reducing recidivism. This is really important right now because we've got proposed legislation regarding expungement and good time credit release programs, as well as the correctional facilities have been releasing many more individuals to reduce the population due to COVID. So it's a critical time to secure this funding for reentry services to help Virginians return to society after serving their time. I hope it's the will of the committee to include these critical initiatives in the new proposed budget amendment with amendments. And I thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, colleagues.
Thank you, Delegate.
Next up is Delegate McQuinn on page 25.
Good morning, and thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman and members of committee, I have three budget amendments. I'm going to sort of explain two in one explanation, and that is looking at budget amendment 145-7H and 482-37H. These two amendments would restore the funding to expand access to school meals. $4.1 million a year would expand eligibility for free breakfast and lunch to include students that are currently eligible for the reduced price category. When we passed the budget in March, the cost was 5.3. It has since gone down because additional schools are participating in the federal community eligibility provision. Funding has become even more critical as a result of COVID-19. As we all know, this pandemic has negatively affected many working families, and more Virginians than ever are experiencing financial hardship and struggling with providing food to their students. These funds were unallotted, and we are asking that they will be restored under this order so we can continue this nutritional program. And then, Mr. Chairman, the next one is item 273-1H. This amendment replaces the $20 million distribution of state recordation taxes that was redirected to Hampton Road Regional Transit with remaining transportation dedicated recordation tax revenues and a one-time use of the general fund. Legislation that was enacted in 2020 General Assembly included changes to the distribution of state recordation tax revenues to cities and counties. And it has affected many counties across the Commonwealth as a result of that. So this change in distribution took place in the session in conference committee and allowed little time for more than 100 affected local governments to respond. This funding certainly could be used again to address transportation and educational needs of communities across this Commonwealth. So we're asking that those funds would be addressed. And this amendment does not impact existing funds to Northern Virginia or Hampton Road Regional Transit. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Delegate.
And next up is Delegate Reed, whose amendments begin on page 27.
Thank you, and thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. I'd like to start with budget amendment number 131, hashtag 2H. This is to provide the Virginia Employment Commission with additional discretionary authority to be able to process claims during the COVID-19 pandemic. Just to kind of set the stage, right now, VEC is dealing with about 250,000 ongoing claims, and in the last week that we have for reporting, they had almost 11,500 new claims. So what this budget amendment would do is this would give them the discretion to actually redirect staff resources from collecting erroneous overpayments that are less than or equal to $500 for a single individual, and instead direct those resources to actually processing new claims or adjudicating claims that are in questions. This would, of course, not apply to any fraud investigations, but this gives them the authority to be able to get money to the people who are applying for new claims and ongoing claims so that they can address the needs that they have for themselves and their families. The other thing that this budget amendment would do is it would also direct that VEC would implement a phone-in system that would allow for callers to be able to be put into a callback queue and then for the members of VEC staff to actually call back through those individuals and contact them. As I think we all know that we're probably getting a whole lot of calls and emails from individuals who are having problems with VEC. So hopefully this particular amendment would allow them to be able to have additional discretionary authority and be able to address these things. The second amendment that I'd like to draw the committee's attention to is 131. I'm sorry, let me look at that one again. It is 391. Number 1H, and this is to establish an emergency 911 border response work group within the Department of Public Safety and Homeland Security. Now, while you might not necessarily think why this is COVID-19 related, what I'd like to draw your attention to is that about a year ago, an individual down in Brunswick County, which I believe is in Delegate Tyler's district, a retired Navy veteran, he suffered a illness and he was on the Virginia side. And then when they made phone calls, it routed over to the North Carolina side. And due to the delay in emergency groups responding, he ended up dying. This year during the COVID-19 pandemic, because of the fact that we actually had all of the pools closed here in Northern Virginia, there was a young African-American man in Loudoun County who was swimming in Goose Creek and he then went under. And when they placed the call to 911, it routed across the river over to Montgomery County. There was a delay in responding, and unfortunately, it suffered in this young man's death also. And so what I'd like to do, because I think we recognize that this is something that is a systemic problem that is happening across the state, is direct the public safety and Homeland Security folks to establish a work group to be able to work with all of the different stakeholders and be able to identify what it is that we need to be able to do to address this going forward. The last budget item that I would like to address is 482.20, number 11H. And this is to fully restore the $12.5 million for expanding the Virginia Business Ready sites. And we've done a pretty good job as a state as being able to address COVID-19. And what this does is this is one of those things where we need to start looking at how we're going to begin investing in the economy so that the economy can grow in a post-COVID-19 manner. And these types of jobs, which are building out basic infrastructure, are things that can be done outside, socially distancing. And the other thing is that it gives us the opportunity to be able to be in place when businesses start looking around and they go, where's a good state to do business? Where's a good state that has addressed COVID-19 and has business-ready sites ready for me to be able to move my facility there? So those are my three amendments, Mr. Chairman, and I appreciate the committee's consideration.
Thank you, Delegate.
And next up is Delegate Rush on page 38.
Hey, thank you, Ann. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. I have my first budget amendment I'd like to talk about today is item 313, number 1H. And it gives flexibility for caregivers in the Medicaid realm for at-home care. And this, currently what we're allowed during the COVID-19 is for relatives to be the primary caregiver for at-home services. And that is supposed to expire on January 31 in 2021. And I'm not sure we're going to be past the COVID-19 crisis at that point. So what this allows is family members to take care of the in-home care of Medicaid eligible folks, and it keeps from having other folks come into the home and possibly threatening them with COVID exposure. So I'd hope we'd be able to extend that for at least the rest of the budget year. Number two, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, is number 3851 or number 1H. And this deals with a rural Virginia African American Museum. Currently in Montgomery County, we have the Christiansburg Institute. Christiansburg Institute was founded in 1866. It's founded by Captain Schaefer, a Union soldier and Baptist minister, and was established to educate freed slaves. And then, Mr. Chairman, in 1896, Booker T. Washington became an advisor to the curriculum. And later on, the facility was taken over by Montgomery County and operated as a regional high school for African-Americans during segregation. Educated African-Americans from 15 local counties. What I'd like to do is have $100,000 for to study how this could become a rural Virginia African-American museum where we can educate folks about our history and how we've come a long way, and we still have ways to go. And then finally, Mr. Chairman, is 429, number 1H. And Mr. Chairman, this is limitation on parole eligibility. And, you know, we've talked a lot about parole over the last few months and in this special session. This is one I hope we can all agree on. This limits the eligibility of parole, actually makes them not eligible for murderers, convicted murderers, convicted killers, who the body of the victim has not been found. And so if this individual, the convicted person, has not gave up the location of the victim, I surely hope they would not be eligible for parole to be walking around the town where they murdered a loved one of a family, and then that family not know where that victim was. So I hope that's one that we can all agree on, that if you're a convicted murderer and you're up for eligible for parole, you need to give up the victim's body, or you can not be eligible. So thank you, Mr. Chairman. That's my three.
Thank you, Delegate.
Mr. Chairman, last up is Delegate Sickles. His amendments begin on page 41. Mark, you're still muted.
Delegate Sickles,
I apologize. Thank you. I was thank you, Ms. Chairman, for this opportunity to talk about three of the many amendments that I put in on behalf of the healthcare infrastructure of Virginia. A lot of problems that we have that have been exacerbated by COVID-19 response. Unfortunately, as a lot of parts of this budget, we left on March 12th with a big improvement in our whole healthcare approach on many things that we had been inadequately funding over the years, and we've lost most of that. Three that I will point out today. One is the 40-quarter rule That's 482.2, number 6H. We're one of six states that essentially require a permanent legal resident to wait 10 years to be able to be eligible for Medicaid. The federal law requires that 5 years, but this is a relatively inexpensive amendment that will help a lot of people. In 21, it's only $1.2 million. The nursing home situation, many of you know that we were able to divert some funds, $20 a day, to the nursing home industry per patient when COVID started, from insurance program that wasn't being used because of the decline in elective surgeries and all the other stuff that people declined to do during the early parts of the pandemic. This would extend that $20 a day to date certain for the nursing home operators, so they'll know how to plan. It extends it until June 30th, or 3 months after the emergency order is removed, whatever comes first. And then I'm proposing the same thing in 479.102H to provide this $20 a day to Medicaid providers. But there are many amendments in here that tries to restore the rates. We have a crisis in Northern Virginia with being able to take care of our most vulnerable citizens. So I'm hoping we can make progress in this interim special session budget, and then, of course, work harder on this when we come back in January. So thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Delegate Sickles. And I think that that concludes all of our budget amendments.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, it does.
Okay, at this time, we have one more item on our agenda, and I'm going to acknowledge Delegate Reed at this time.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, having voted on the prevailing side for which House Bill 5013 was not reported, I move that House Bill 513 be reconsidered, and I'd like to speak to that motion.
Is it 501?
Second.
All in favor of the motion, please vote with a sign of aye.
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 Okay, Delegate Reed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As we're all working very thoroughly and very thoughtfully through the criminal justice reform measures in this very compressed special session, I have to admit that I identified a last-minute concern with the second portion of Delegate Bourne's legislation. This part of the bill addresses the potential liability of law enforcement offices as it relates to their off-duty actions by their personnel. And I want to thank Delegate Bourne. He and I spoke a couple times yesterday, and we were able to work through this particular item. So that's the reason why I wanted to make a motion to reconsider this, so that the amended version can be brought before the committee and we can move forward. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Delegate Bourne.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I did email to staff the amended version. Not sure if they sent that out or if it's up online or available now.
Mr. Chairman, I just now sent that out.
Okay.
We weren't in a posture to do so until it was offered and the reconsideration was accepted, but it has been sent to all of the committee members now.
And so, Mr. Chairman, if I could, I'll just explain the changes. For those who either are on courts, maybe there's not anybody on courts that's also on appropriations, but who followed that courts committee and the robust discussion we had on this bill, I committed to everyone there to continue to work on it to make it a better bill. And up until the time of the committee yesterday, I've been emailing and trying to put the final touches on a revised draft. Because as Delegate Reed expressed, there had been some concern about imposing liability on officers who were off duty. And I understand and appreciate the concerns. However, in working through the original draft, the thing that we were trying to address is those situations where a police officer, a sheriff's deputy is in uniform working an off-duty event. And so they would give the appearance and people would reasonably conclude that they are on duty, they are in uniform using the tools and clothing that has been provided to them, and then they cause serious bodily injury or even death in that off-duty situation. They've given the impression that they're on duty, and therefore their employer, I thought and still think, that they should be liable.
However, in trying to, you know, figure out how we move this forward, I've changed that section, and it basically limits it to those instances where they're on duty and they breach in whole or in part of their duty, the employer's duty to reasonably supervise, hire, and train those law enforcement officers. So whether it's the public entity or the private entity, that's the person whoever's contracted or hired them for that particular purpose is going to be subject to liability should the court or finder of fact decide that they are liable. In addition, we've eliminated in whole the new 801 42.9 dealing with vulnerable victims. Still got some issues to work through on that one.
Okay, thank you, Delegate Bourne. I think we may need a motion to move the substitute, and then we'll take comments from the committee.
Move the substitute.
Second.
Second.
All those in favor, use those out of aye.
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 Okay, at this time, with the substitute having been moved, are there any questions or comments from the committee in regards to HB 5013 with the substitute?
Mr. Chairman.
Delegate Cox.
Mr. Chairman, first of all, thank you last night for giving me, and I think Republicans, a heads up this bill was coming up. But I have to say, I do think this is a little unique situation. As I recall, doing appointments, there is no overlap between courts and appropriations. I don't see the substitute. So I do know we have another meeting. It's a very, very big bill for a lot of us. And we don't have the expertise of the court's members here. So I would request, since we have another meeting, that we take a bow for the day.
Second.
It has been moved and seconded that HB 5013 bye for the day. All those in favor, please use both sign of aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
No.
No.
I think we're going to do a recorded vote on this. Clerk, call the roll, please.
Mr. Chair, please bear with me for one moment.
So those of you who are in favor of it going by for the day will vote yes. Those who oppose will vote no.
Delegate Hurst.
I vote no.
Delegate Hurst votes no. Delegate Davis.
Aye.
Delegate Davis votes aye.
Please close the roll. The motion to go by for today fails.
Mr. Chairman.
Delegate Cox.
Mr. Chairman, in that case, this bill got a lot of debate, I know, in courts, and certainly in appropriations, we had some debate the other day. I think if you look at all the various law enforcement bills, and obviously some of us think they could be very detrimental to law enforcement, this is the one that probably stands out more than any other one. And when you talk to, whether it be representatives of the state police or local law enforcement, this is the one they fear, because they feel like with qualified immunity, they will lose a tremendous amount of folks not only from their current ranks, but their recruitment will, I think, go into a tailspin. And I know we're going to hear the argument that you don't want those kind of people anyway. I would totally disagree. I think all of us would agree that we have no idea what it's like to be a law enforcement officer on the front line and the pressures that you're under. I would say in most cases, they make very, very good judgments. We want very well qualified officers, but we also want them, it's just whether you're a teacher, whether you play sports. The worst thing that can happen to you is you're second guessing yourself all the time. In the back of your mind is, I can always be sued. And I can tell you as a teacher, you know, if I had a good building administrator that I knew was going to back me up, and I was really cautious about ever sending kids to the office. If I didn't have that, and teachers don't have that, I tell you what they do, they hide in their classroom, too many of them, and they basically, because of the liability issues. So I think what we're setting up here is exactly the opposite of what we would like to have. And that is law enforcement making really good split-second decisions instead of always having in the back of their mind that they can be civilly sued. So I don't think this concept's improved a lot from yesterday. I applaud the committee yesterday for, to me, making some people crossing the aisle, making the right decision. And so I would hope that we would defeat this substitute. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman.
Who am I looking at? Delegate Jones.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Speaking to the bill.
Delegate Jones.
Thank you. And I respect the comments that Delegate Cox just put forth. And I would also just like to say that I understand, and I think we all respect and revere law enforcement in ways that I think gets distorted. I think none of us want to undermine their ability to do their job, their ability to hire, their ability to recruit and retain good people and train them. But I think that no entity should be able to sort of hate to go above the law. I mean, in my job as a lawyer, I'm subject to being recalled or for malpractice. You know, I think there should be no fear, and we're not, and lawyers and law enforcement officers won't be second guessing themselves in the line of duty. If they know that the decision is right, if they feel like they are acting as a reasonable and prudent officer would be, they have nothing to worry about. And I think that, again, and I said it yesterday, and I'll say it again, if you have folks who are worried about using too much force, I'm really not sure that those are the folks that we want to have on our police forces. And I have the utmost faith in our sheriffs and our police officers and our law enforcement to train these folks to do the right thing. And what we're talking about are situations that happen so infrequently. But I challenge everybody in this committee to take a step back, to think about a situation in which your loved one, your family member, your friend, your neighbor was subject to an incident in which they were the subject of unnecessary force. And wouldn't you want them an opportunity to be heard in court? And I think all of us as public servants and people who respect the Constitution of Virginia and the Constitution of the United States want to make sure that your constitutional rights are protected. And if your constitutional rights are violated, you should have your day in court. And so that's why this bill is a good idea. It's a great step. I encourage everybody to vote yes on this, to report it to the floor.
Delegate Sickles.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to associate myself with those remarks of Delegate Jones. I couldn't say it that well myself. Something is wrong in this country. And when we see this violence every month, every few weeks, inexplicable to me how people can get shot in the back and walk away without any sanction. And so I just hope that we will pass this as one step to getting a handle on this continued violence that we're seeing in some police officers. It's not everybody, but it's enough that people are not changing their behavior. I'm just astounded when this happens every few weeks. Like, how can this happen? So I'm just on that basis alone. I hope that we will put in place something that will help people think about what they're doing before they shoot people in the back. So I hope you'll vote yes on this bill.
Mr. Chairman.
Who do we have here?
Betsy Carr.
Delegate Carr.
Yes, sir. Thank you. I also would like to associate myself with the comments of Delegate Jones. I have one question just on the text of the bill that came in front of us. I'm not a lawyer, but in Section A, what it has, who under color of law, I'm not familiar with that term. Can somebody explain that to me?
Delegate Boren?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. And Delegate Carr, are you referring to the new language or the original language?
I'm just pulled up the language that Ann Oman sent.
Okay. Section A.
And it says any law enforcement officer as defined in 9.1-101 who, under color of law, I don't know if that's a special term or whether that happens to be a...
Yeah, it's just...
That just means the mere semblance.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, the committee operates...
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman. One second, please. I think I did see Delegate Knight raise up. And who else did I have? I thought I heard
Delegate Austin, Mr. Chairman.
Delegate Austin. We're going to go Delegate Knight and then Delegate Austin.
Mr. Chairman, we have a severe Yes, sir. We have a severe law enforcement and corrections officer shortage. We've tried to financially incentivize these positions through the years to not much avail. And this bill is going to make the hiring so much worse. I can tell you from my personal perspective, if I was a young man or lady and I was considering a profession in law enforcement or corrections, and I thought that's what I would want to do, and I looked and I saw where I had the threat of being sued, or if it was one of my sons, I would advise them not to go into this profession. Because even if you're innocent, you lose. We've heard many, many times of frivolous lawsuits being filed by some unscrupulous lawyers that'll sue anybody. And that's just like police officers. We have a lot of very, very good attorneys in the state of Virginia, but we have some that'll sue anybody. And even if you're innocent, because someone made an unfounded complaint, you still lose. It still ruins you financially. Thank you.
We're going to have Delegate Austin and then Delegate Brewer.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, thank you. This bill is very disturbing to me and to law enforcement. I've been contacted by numerous law enforcement officers who say that this is going to end their career. They've got many, many years of service. They're very dedicated to their profession. But this bill can be very devastating, and they're not willing to jeopardize their livelihood and their homes in the event of a civil case. We, for years, have handed down to law enforcement the mental illness issues of society, the drug-related problems of society, and law enforcement has not had the funds or the tools to address these appropriately. We're incarcerating people, putting them in jail, and then sending them to court and fining them and doing nothing to address their mental illness or their drug-related problems. And just like Delegate Knight said, I just don't think that anyone is going to want to pursue a career in law enforcement under these circumstances. And as Delegate Carr said, she's not an attorney, and neither am I. And that's why I think this bill should have gone back to courts. It should go back to courts and be properly vetted and language gotten right before we intend to approve a piece of legislation that's not been properly vetted. I just hope that the committee will look seriously at this legislation. We're going to lose a lot of good law enforcement people. And yes, you're right. A few bad apples can ruin the whole bunch. And I don't think we've had that many issues in the Commonwealth where there's been bad decisions made and law enforcement has acted inappropriately. So I would just ask the committee to look very seriously at this bill and let's reject this legislation. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you, Delegate Brewer.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I first want to say, speaking to the bill, there are several pieces of legislation that are going to the floor within probably the coming week that are going to address several issues I think that many people across the Commonwealth have expressed concern with. When it deals with qualified immunity, though, the key word there is qualified. And I think that, our law enforcement agencies clearly know how to handle these situations. But I agree with several that spoke before. Nobody dislikes a good cop worse or a bad cop worse than a good cop. I truly believe that 99% of the people that work in this profession serve with integrity, with honesty, and respect to all communities. And I believe that legislation that will be going to the floor will address that. However, this is not it. This borderlines on one of the most dangerous pieces of legislation that will affect people working in law enforcement for a generation. We say that we want people that are qualified. We say that we want people that are upstanding. But when you have people that we're asking to go into a line of work for barely above the poverty level to work already, and then we're talking about the opportunity to destroy their entire career, because now with social media, the reality is that we try people in the court of public opinion before we allow investigations to go forth the way things should go. However, the word qualified is the key word here, and we need to remember that. In regard to where this bill is going, and I think we can all read the tea leaves, I don't think there's a member on this committee that condones violence in our communities ever, period. So a vote against this legislation, and I obviously will be voting against this, is not condoning that. So I also want that to be very, very clear. So I hope members will give this some thought. Truly, I hope that many of their constituents will reach out, and I hope the law enforcement members that live in their districts will reach out and voice their concerns on this bill. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Delegate Jones.
Mr. Chairman.
Delegate Jones.
Mr. Chairman, this is Delegate Fires.
Mr. Chairman, I will Delegate Ferris, and I can go after him.
All right, Delegate Ferris.
Mr. Chairman and my friends on the committee, you know, I think we need to step back here and just think just a minute. I really agree with what Delegate Sickles said and what Delegate Austin said, and we need to think about who in their right mind would run away from a law enforcement officer when they're trying to investigate and talk to them. When these police officers are dealing with these mentally ill and these people that are hyped up on these drugs, we've passed legislation, or it appears we're passing legislation that restricts how they can hold them and what they can do. Nobody in their right mind should want to hurt anybody. And I don't care if you're a suspect or a law enforcement officer, but when we are continue to cripple these police officers, I just don't see any way we keep restricting them and crippling how they can do their job that this will make this situation any better. And I really think we need to think about this and how we do this going forward. I think we do at this point. I agree that I don't see it in Virginia, but I agree that nationwide there is a problem, and there may be some in Virginia that I'm unaware of.
Right.
But we're going to make it harder to hire the right people to do these jobs if we continue to go down this road, and it's only going to get worse. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Delegate Jones.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to address a couple of things because I heard a couple of my colleagues talk about how they're not lawyers, and so I want to give you guys a quick legal perspective because that's what I do. I'm sitting in my law office as we speak. This is a defense, and if you read the text of the bill, it says that this shall not be used as a defense. This does not mean that if a police officer is sued or a police department is sued, that they automatically lose. All it says is that they're in court with a judge or a jury. So let's not forget that. That's what makes America special, is that you're innocent until proved guilty, and you have a right to a trial by your jury and your peers. So let's please dispel with this notion that this means that all law enforcement is going to be flushed down the drain. Let's also think about a situation where we have people walking around, who are basically above the law. None of us as members of the General Assembly are above the law. We are only seeking to provide people redress in court. And you know what? I will tell you all, I will take a whole bunch of frivolous lawsuits if it means that someone who is shot and killed, or who was shot seven times in the back, gets a day in court. That means more to me. And I say that not from a position as an attorney, but from a position as a human. I think if you have seen the things that we've all seen over the last 6 months, but really the last 30 years, Rodney King was beaten in front of a camera 30 years ago, and those guys walked out scot-free. And over the last 400 years, there's a system that has been built that is not working for people of color in this country and in Virginia. And this is a signal to us that you don't necessarily care about us, and you don't care about our rights and our livelihood. I watched the George Floyd video. I could feel that officer's knee on my neck as I watched it. I could feel the bullets in my back as I watched the video of Jacob Blake. This is a chance for Virginia to do the right thing and to do right by people. I promise you, this will not have the impact, the financial impact or the chilling effect that you that folks are saying that it is. Those are red herrings. This is a is an opportunity for our citizens to have their constitutional rights protected. So my friends on the right, if you talk about protecting liberty, this is, you should vote for this bill. This is a bill to give people a chance to be heard. These ideas that we are somehow sort of dispelling with law enforcement, that's not true. They have all the rights and responsibilities that we entrust with them, and we just want them to do it properly. And that's what this bill does, and I would encourage everybody to vote yes.
Okay, committee, this is how we're going to proceed. I'm going to hear from Delegate McQuinn. I'm going to hear from Delegate Bloxham. I'm going to give the last word to Delegate Bourne, and then I'm going to entertain a motion in that order. Delegate McQuinn.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Chair, I just want to say to those, particularly my colleagues, my friend who are on the right, that we are in a critical time in this nation. The times are so serious. I think there is a mentality that is existing that's coming from Washington that says it is okay to commit violence. It's okay to shoot people in the back, to put your knee on their necks. It's okay. I mean, I think there's a mentality that is being pushed about across this nation. And we must realize that these are critical times. We also, I just ask you to, for some of us, we are tired. We are extremely tired by what we are seeing, what we know that is occurring, and how our communities are being treated. But make no mistake, it is only because the camera is on that we are able to witness for ourselves some of these dynamics. This has been happening for years. It has been happening. You know, you can go into any Black community and they can talk about how they were mistreated, how someone spoke to them. It has just been a reality for the Black communities. And when we look at what is happening across the country, and I know my good friend Delegate Cox said that we don't want police officers second guessing themselves. Yes, we do. We want, for 8.5 minutes, someone was on George Floyd's neck. There should have been a second guess at that time. And I just encourage you all to understand, you know, where we are, where to walk in our shoes just for a moment. Because long before there was a camera, a video, we were dealing with these things in the Black community. And it's unfortunate, but this is where we are. And we must be holding people accountable. Nobody's more supportive of police officers than I am. But it is only the bad apples that we are trying to address. I believe majority, 99% of the police officers are great officers in our community, doing what they're supposed to, respecting everyone and looking at each person, you know, in a humane way. But for those who are not, we must do something. We must set this in an order so that those who have decided that they're above the law. We've got to stop it. And if you all have a better way to address it, then bring that to the table. But I'm saying to you today, please walk in our shoes. My husband, my son, and even I was approached by a bad police officer while walking my dog. The car accelerated toward me. The dog and I jumped in the ditch. I had a baseball cap on and a sweatsuit. I turned around to say, "What the heck?" And on the side of the car that accelerated toward me was one of our police, county's police name on it. And I'm not going to call the name because I don't want to put them out, but it was one that I represented. And so that says to me that I was walking, it was a Black person, and that obviously there was some problem. And so I just ask you again to look at what's going on. We're not trying to attack or address those who are doing it right, getting it right. It is only those who refuse to look at every man and woman, boy and girl, as a part of humanity and treat them that way.
Thank you, Delegate Bloxham.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm not a lawyer, and I don't think our side has a lawyer sitting on this committee. And it's my understanding that a bad cop, which is what we're talking about, could be prosecuted today, just not civilly.
They aren't.
And I think what we're doing is lowering the bar to prove or to have them prove that they're a good cop. I just find it a little disheartening that this really needs to go back to the let the lawyers look at it and let them fight and come up with the best bill. I think bringing this to our committee with one or two lawyers on it so they can discuss the nuances of this bill kind of leaves us without being fully vetted. So I really wish that we'd send this back, but I pretty much can read the writing on the wall. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Delegate Borman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I just want to, thank Delegate Jones and Delegate McQuinn for their impassioned remarks. They said a lot of what I'm going to say. Just to address Delegate Bloxham's most recent comment and about having this go back to courts, we discussed this for over an hour. Lawyers debated, they talked, they asked questions. So this has had a full vetting on the substance of the concept, and the bill actually has gotten narrower than when it left courts first. But let me just, for a moment, 2 points I want to make. We've heard a lot about the impact that this bill and increased accountability will have on retention and recruitment, that there's a shortage of law enforcement officers. And let me submit to this committee and anyone else who's watching or listening. We are undergoing a shortage of Black men at the hands of police officers. And they are not being held accountable either criminally, many of them don't get charged, or civilly. And so this bill will help that. This does not prevent a local prosecutor from prosecuting one of these cases criminally. This is the civil side. Number two, I hope everyone on this committee has listened to the type of language that has been used. The types of language that has been used to talk about why we should oppose this bill is exactly the types of systemic and institutionalized racism we are trying to dismantle. And so, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, I certainly appreciate the time this morning. But I have to say that it's not lost on me that once again, we as African Americans have had to work twice as hard to get to where we might be able to see a little bit of light at the end of the tunnel. And so, Mr. Chair, I thank you for your time and your patience with me in this bill.
Thank you. Thank you, Delegate Bourne. At this time, the committee operates by motion.
Move the report.
Second.
It has been moved and second that we report HB 5013 with a substitute. Members, please cast your vote. Mr. Clerk. Delegate Bolivar, Delegate Davis. Clerk should close the roll. I believe the bill reports 12-8. Committee, I want to thank you so very much for your time today. Members of the committee, thank you for your willingness to come to present your budget amendments. Delegate Bourne, thank you for being with us and committee for your comments relative to House Bill 5013. We still have quite a bit of work before us. Staff will continue to be in touch with you. Check your emails periodically as we prepare for our next board committee meeting. Thank you all for this morning, and we stand adjourned.